So here is part one of how AI is going to put me out of a job. So today we're going to be talking about how eye tests, eye scans with the help of AI could have the potential to diagnose children with autism, autism spectrum disorder. And some of these tests and scans are some tests that we do on our patients a lot already, almost every day. And it also comes with the potential to diagnose it a lot earlier in life, very, very young children, which can be super helpful in providing the help and support and treatment to those children as early as possible as well. Now, first you might be wondering, how is this even possible to potentially diagnose someone with autism by just doing an eye scan or an eye test or an eye photo? Well, a lot of times we actually consider the eyeball an extension to the brain. The optic nerve comes directly from the brain to the back of the eye, and those nerves flow and extend through the retina. This is called the retinal nerve fiber layer. And so all these nerves are going directly to the brain, and a lot of times you can actually test for any abnormalities that might be found in the brain. You can actually see them in the eye as well. The first test or scan that we can talk about is actually an eye tracking device that can be used on young patients from 16 to 30 months old. And this is actually an FDA approved diagnostic scan that you can do on children to help diagnose them with autism. The device is called Earlipoint, and basically you have a child look at a screen, look at an image or a video, and it actually tracks what that patient or what that child is looking at and compares it to what other children might be looking at. Now, typically with neurodivergent children or autism, autism spectrum disorder, they are looking for different eye patterns, eye tracking patterns, or no pattern at all when compared to other children. And this is tracking their eye movement 120 frames per second, usually something that we can't tell or not detectable by our eyes, of different types of patterns or what they might be looking at, how scattered their pattern might be. And it actually puts them in this algorithm that can hopefully help people diagnose them with autism. Now, reading about this, and as an eye doctor, I do see limitations here depending on the child, if they're on medications, if they have a visual problem, maybe they have amblyopia, they have one eye that's not working or seeing as well as the other eye. There might be some other issues that are causing eye tracking issues. And so I kind of take that with a grain of salt, but this is an FDA approved device that has been shown to help diagnose autism very early. And so this is something that you can definitely look into. The second one is something called an ERG or electroretinogram. And this is measuring electrical activity that is sent from the retina to the brain when it receives a light response. And what was actually used in this test is called a ret eval. And this is actually a device that we use in our clinic right now to screen for diabetes, diabetic retinopathy, changes to the retina, or glaucoma, changes to the optic nerve or retinal nerve fiber layer. This is something that we use right now. And this is actually what they used in the test to show or screen for any reduced signal that is going from the retina to the brain. The strongest biomarker when they did the test is when they did a single super fast bright light flash to the right eye, and then they put the data into an AI algorithm processing, and the AI actually found out in the high frequency components there definitely was a reduced signal that was sent from the retina to the brain with people that have autism spectrum disorder. Now, in the testing, they tested between 5 and 16 years old. They're hoping that they can develop a way to test that in much younger years in children. And I bet that will be accomplished. Even with the ret eval, the device that we have, that is measuring similar things that we used to test people on and fully hooking them up to measure an ERG. And we're hooking up electrodes to the eyes and the back of the head and everything like that. And now with this ret eval, it is much easier, much quicker, less of a hassle, and I'm guessing it's just going to be getting better from there to be able to test it on younger and younger patients. Now again, just me thinking out loud here, there's definitely limitations here because there are other conditions that can cause a reduced signal as well. Again, is that patient on a certain medication? Does that patient have another different type of eye condition that might be reducing that visual pathway? So those things I think are gonna be studied more, and this is gonna go more in depth, but this is looking promising as a potential way to diagnose autism. The third way, and this could be really exciting, is actually using retinal photographs or fundus photos. And these are types of photos that we take on nearly every patient that walks in the door. I look at these photographs every day, almost on every patient, and we use them to screen for diabetes, diabetic retinopathy, glaucoma, macular degeneration, any type of retinal detachments or retinal holes or any irregularities in the back of the eye. Super helpful tool. And they're going to use this same type of photograph and make it more heavily AI based, where they actually run it into an AI processing model or development model that can actually predict and determine if this patient might have autism. And it's doing this by looking at the optic disc, the optic nerve specifically, and the retinal nerve fiber layer, that extension of those nerves from the brain. And what they're finding is people with autism have a reduced thickness of that retinal nerve fiber layer. And that's what these photographs and what AI is trying to determine. The most recent study of this, they actually took 1,000 children, some that we know were diagnosed with autism and some we know that they don't have autism, and took photographs and actually put them in an AI processing center and developed certain algorithms and models that it could actually spit out and predict who might have autism. Now, in the study, it developed and was able to pick the children with autism with 100% accuracy. Now, when I hear that, kind of red flags go up in my head, and so I think there are some limitations to this as well. First off, the children with autism were tested and had their retinal photos taken in a separate room, less stressful, more calming environment versus the children that don't have autism. Maybe AI is able to determine that, or it might influence AI in some way, just the different setting there. Also, it didn't take into account different ages and ages with different conditions or medications as well. And so there is some factor there, because there may be some medications that might reduce that retinal nerve fiber layer as well. And so could be tricky. I think they have mentioned that they will be testing and doing further studies where they can control for some of those outliers and potential hiccups to the test. And also, I think they'll be using an OCT. Now, an OCT is also a test, a machine, a device that we have in our offices that we use for the similar things. And this can also be a very useful tool in measuring the thickness of that retinal nerve fiber layer, better than a fundus photo. So if they are able to do this test on young children and actually get a quality scan, a quality picture, then I could see this actually being a very helpful tool. So right now, I wouldn't say that, hey, this is 100%. You can actually diagnose children with autism just by taking a retinal photograph and putting it in an AI algorithm. We're not there yet. I can actually see one day us getting to a point to where we're going to take these same tests that we're doing on every patient, the retinal photos, OCT scans, the ERG, and actually being able to put it into an AI algorithm and model where the AI might be able to say, hey, there's the potential that this patient might have this, or maybe this potential this patient might have autism, or will develop autism, or develop diabetes, or already getting into that stage there. Again, might put me out of a job, but I can't help but be excited on the potential that we're seeing here, and I'm just actually excited to be part of it. So hopefully this can develop further, and this will be something that maybe in 10 years, we're just doing it routinely on patients. That'd be really exciting. Now, I'm going to continue doing a series on this. There are different AI models out there that can help us detect for Parkinson's and Alzheimer's. And yeah, again, might put me out of a job, but nevertheless, it's exciting. So if you want to keep watching, definitely click right here and let me know if you have any questions. Stay focused.